also just remind everybody. Grace is taken. Second verse. Now turn down. Somewhat hard to get a grasp on as far as our carnal mind goes. Excuse me. We hear the question many times of where are you in your relationship with the Lord? And it would almost seem as though in our carnal mind we have some way of making a calculated measure of what our relationship is like or what someone else's relationship might be like based on. You know, the Bible says, oh, you'll know them by their fruits. And we take some of these scriptures and we use those scriptures sometimes to categorize our own self or other people around us. Before I forget, I just remembered Matt wanted me to mention that his services are available. If you need some help doing anything at all, he's available. Just raise your hand over there, shiny on top. But he's here, and he says he feels the Lord has him here for whatever time as it is, the season that he's in, and his services are available. If you need something, need some help with something, let him know. He's just looking to do whatever it is you need done. Okay, so we look at the question, where are you in your relationship with the Lord? And we think, well, you know, how do we gauge that? What do we look at when we see that? And God gives us a perfect example of everything we need right here in this book. And the examples that he gives is pretty amazing. When you look at the 12 disciples, these are hand-picked people. Jesus picked these 12 all by himself. He, for a very specific purpose, chose every one of the 12 disciples. Let's go to John chapter 20. It's pretty amazing that these disciples, the 12 of them, you'd think that if you were Jesus and you were to go out and you were going to minister all over the place and you're going to go talk and you're going to preach to a lot of people and you're going to be doing a lot of things, you'd pick out, I don't know about you, but I would pick out the 12 that I thought were going to be the biggest help. I wouldn't pick out somebody out of my 12 that was going to cause me problems. Let's look at the book of John 20. Verse 24 and 25. Now Jesus had appeared to the 12, to 11 disciples. Thomas wasn't there. And he appeared to the here's the band of 12. They'd worked with Jesus. They'd been around Jesus. They'd helped him do a lot of things. They'd seen him do all the miracles. They'd seen him be crucified. They had watched all this transpire over his lifetime. And now here the 11 have seen Jesus after his return, and Thomas wasn't there. But now we're going to go to verse 24 of John 20. And it says, but Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples, therefore, said unto him, we have seen the Lord. Now, these 11 guys are 11 buddies. There's 11 handpicked that God, Jesus put them all together. And now the 11 of them are coming to the one and say, hey, we saw him. He came. He appeared to us. He's back. And old Thomas, verse 25. And he said unto them, except I see his hands and the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into the side, I will not believe. Now, is that the kind of buddy you'd pick to be one of your 12? One that was going to be of doubt all the time? One that wasn't going to lie after he'd watched it all happen? And been around you while you did all these miracles and all these things, and watched you crucified and buried, and heard you promise that in 3 days I would rise. And then when the other 11 that you've been hanging out with, these 11 buddies, been hanging out, you've been praying with them, you've been meeting in upper rooms, you had all kinds of miracles happen right before you. Here's one that says, nah, I don't believe it. You don't want to just poke him in the eye, will you? I don't believe it. So how can you not believe it? What do you want me to do? Well, until I see his hand, I put my finger in his hand, and I thrust my hand inside, I ain't going to believe. Now, we know that Jesus appears to Thomas later on and tells Thomas. Thomas realizes his mistake when Jesus appears. And Thomas says, well, I believe. And Jesus told Thomas, greater is he that believes without having to see than he that has to see. But see, again, this is one of the 12. This is one of the 12 disciples. They were picked, hand-picked. Let's go over to Luke chapter 22. Here's another pretty amazing fellow that Jesus picked to be one of his 12. Luke 22 and verse 21. They're sitting down to eat right before they come to get Jesus. Right before he's betrayed. And Jesus sitting at the table with the 12 that he picked to get the work done that he needed to get done. Verse 21 of chapter 22 in Luke, it says, but behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. The one that is going to sell out for 25 shekels of silver, he's going to sell me off to be crucified. He's sitting here at the table with us. And I picked him on purpose. I picked him on purpose. Just like I picked Thomas. Just like I picked all 12 of them. I picked them for a very specific purpose. Not only the purposes that we see here, but that purpose continues to minister today. It continues to serve purpose today. The reason that Jesus picked the 12 that he picked. Now think about that for a moment. You're Jesus. You're God. You're on this earth. And you start out and you begin to pick your 12 disciples. But see, you're not looking at what's... He doesn't focus on what's happening right before his eyes because he knows how this all has to work out. He knows what tools he's going to need. If you're going to go do a job and you know, and you do this job a lot and you know exactly how this is going to turn out, you grab your tools that you're going to need and then you go do the job. And that's exactly what Jesus was doing when he picked the 12 disciples. He knew exactly how this all had to happen. He knew what had to be written down. He knew the testimonies that had to be there. So when the day came that somebody needed to be witness to, that these words would witness to those souls. Jesus didn't pick the 12 perfect people that we would have picked. If we were to take on this task... If God come to me and said, okay, you're going to be down here 33 years and then they're going to come and one of your buddies is going to sell you out and they're going to hang you on a cross, I'd be real careful of my 12 buddies. I wouldn't be picking on Judas out. But see, Jesus knew this has to happen because, in other words, if it doesn't happen exactly the way it's supposed to happen, then it won't work. There won't be any power in the blood if it's not done right. There won't be any witness of Jesus Christ if it's not done exactly the way the Father puts it together. Exactly the way God leads me to go, I have to go in order for it to all turn out right. Let's go all the way back to Exodus. The scripture comes to mind, God is yet the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is in control of the good, and God is in control of the bad, and God puts in place the good events and God puts in place the bad events and the evil events. These are all part of what he does. In Exodus chapter 9 and verse 16, God tells Moses to tell Pharaoh, and in very deed of this cause have I raised thee up for to show thee in thee my power and that my name may be declared throughout all the earth. That's God. He told Moses, tell Pharaoh, you tell Pharaoh that in my name, I put him where he's at so that my glory would be shown throughout the whole world. Even though he does evil, even though he is who he is, I knew all of that and I put him there that this would happen in the fashion it has to happen. Handpicked. You know, a lot of times, Jesus would take James and Peter and John. Now there's 12. He picked all 12 of them. And for certain occasions, he would take James and Peter and John. Let's go to Matthew chapter 17. Matthew 17, verses 1 through 3. After 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up on a high mountain, apart, and was transfigured before them. And his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto him Moses and Elias, talking with him. Now, he didn't take all 12. He took James and Peter and John, and he does this a few times in Scripture. For whatever reason, God had a reason. God had handpicked these 12. And he had a purpose for each one of them. And each one of them still witnesses us today. It still lets us know that no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter what kind of life you live, no matter about any of those things, the power in the blood surpasses all of those things. It doesn't differentiate. It doesn't work a little bit better over here than over there. And it doesn't matter if you're in the back row or the front row. That has no bearing on it. Because if you're here today and you've accepted Jesus Christ, he has handpicked you for a purpose. Just as he handpicked them 12. He has handpicked you to do what he would have done in his will. We're going to see it. It makes no different or unique and our relationship with God, it is not measured by anything other than our faith. How strong is our faith? That's what we work on. That's what he teaches us to. That's what he takes us to strengthen your faith, your belief, so you're not like Thomas. He gives us perfect examples from one extreme, one that will betray him, to James and Peter and John that takes him up to show him the transfiguration into heaven. And all in between. And we're all fit somewhere in one of those 12. I would venture to say that you could probably go through the scriptures and study each one of the disciples and find one that matches up kind of with the way who you are. For that purpose, he gave us the 12. That we could look at it and say, wow, how strong is my faith? Do I trust and believe him so much? And do I care for him so much? And do I want to be with him so much that if he was here today and he was going to go up on the Mount of Transfiguration, that he would pick me? Is that where I'm at in my faith? Because that's the only determining factor. There's not different levels of Christianity. It doesn't go over here to you, okay, here you are, you got saved, and you're a little bit saved, and you get a little more saved, and a little bit, and you skip. No, no, no. You either get saved or you don't. It's not a graduation. The graduation is your faith. The graduation is how much do you believe, and how much faith do you put in, and how strong is your faith, and how willing are you to go out and to tell somebody else. Because as your faith grows, as you decide you want more, and you want more, Gary says, that's a whole lot of God. It is, but it ain't enough. We saw that video last week where Billy Graham says that he was asked in an interview, if you could do it over, would you do it different? I was always amazed at how quick he answered that question. Yes, I'd do it different. I was like, wow, Billy Graham, you would do it different? And the reporter was astonished the same way. What would you do different? I would spend more time praying and meditating and telling God how much I love you. When we accept Christ, when we come to a place in our life that we realize that we're not going to make it on our own, we realize that I might have been a pretty good guy all my life, but I didn't live all the way to here without sin. And the only thing that's going to get, only the wages of sin, according to the scripture, is death. If we sin against God, the wages of that is death. Doesn't matter how good a guy you are, doesn't matter if you have lots of hair, no hair, lots of whiskers, no whiskers, doesn't matter. First, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and 17.